welcome to each one of you. Invite you to move on in as we begin to worship this morning. As we continue to worship, this morning is the beginning of the Advent season. Last week we had Thanksgiving, and we had a wall of thanks up here on each side. We brought words up that we were thankful for. And if you weren't here, or if you have something else that you'd like to put on the wall, we'll leave these up for a while. There's little sticky notes up here, and you can come and write things that God has blessed you with, ways that you're thankful that God has worked in your heart. And we just want to continue to give thanks. As we move into this season of Advent, we are focusing a little differently, and our word today is love. And so we want to sing the love of God, because we can't love others unless we really fully understand that God has first loved us. So we invite you to sing the love of God with us.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty bear bowed down with care, God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin.
As I mentioned, this morning is the first Sunday that we think about Advent. And Advent really is about coming. It's about this coming of the Messiah. And over 2,000 years ago, the Messiah came in a form of a baby. And so we celebrate, we remember, I mean, Christmas. This is the day that we think about. But we also think about coming and Christ's return and Christ, the Messiah, continually coming and being present with us. And so we want to remember in the coming weeks, Advent. Our overall theme as we think about Advent this year, we would like to focus on light in darkness. And really being aware that in a dark place, a light has amazing effect, has amazing power to bring light. And we want to be Christ-like. We want to be Christ's presence in a dark world and how we might think of ourselves in that way. So each week we will light a candle, we will remember, and this season we're going to invite us as a church body to sort of sit in that darkness and sort of pray and allow God to move you during this time of silence, during this time of prayer and reflection. It won't be too long that you can't make it through, but just a moment of reflection in the quietness and hearing God in maybe a different way, and then we'll continue to move on. So we will reflect at this time on Advent.
For God so loved the world in this way, he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16.
A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. John 13:34.
In the world we see oppression, turmoil, and hate. But God's word shows us the way of love. And we as Christians, as Christ followers, are commanded to love one another. And love may not always be easy or the easy way, but our love can influence real change, one heart at a time. And today we light the candle of love.
to your children praying. Lord, send your Spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Advent is one of my favorite times of year. This Advent, this Christmas season, as we move into a time of preparing and wait and expectation. I think at times in the midst of busyness, we just need those times to just pause and reflect, to slow down and remember and wait. As we go to a time of prayer, we have people in our community who need prayer this holiday season, this Christmas season. Please continue to be in prayer for Glenda Miller and Doris Hall, who were released from the hospital. Continue to be in prayer for their recovery, for their healing. Be in prayer as well. Continue to be in prayer for Dwayne and Irma. We announced last week that Irma had lost a sister last Saturday. Dwayne Stutzman lost a sister as well. So please continue to be in prayer for them as they mourn. And then we are in prayer for Chris Kaufman as well, whose stepdad Everett passed away early this morning. Please remember that family in prayer as well. And then be in prayer for Doug, who is Verda and Squeaky's son, as he had surgery this last Wednesday and is in the hospital recovering. Just pray for him as he recovers from surgery. At this time, if you are in need of prayer this upcoming week, for whatever reason, whatever it would be, one of the things that we do is we pray for each other. We lay hands because we believe in that touch, that there's power. So if you are in need of prayer this upcoming week in some way, we ask that you stand. And if you would like for those around you to gather, just continue to stay standing. And people will gather around for prayer. So are there any in need of prayer this upcoming week? Would you gather around those who are standing? Let's pray. Lord, listen to your people praying. Listen to your people calling out in need of you. Father, whether that need is healing, as in the case of Doris and Glenda and Doug, or as it is in the need of comfort in a time of mourning for Dwayne and Irma and Chris. Father, we pray that your comfort would just be with them, that your healing presence would be within them. Father, for those who are standing, Father, you know what they need, whether it be healing or comfort or a discerning word from you. Wisdom and guidance, Father, whatever it would be, you know who they are, you know what they need, and I pray that your presence would dwell with them this week. Father, as we enter this season of hope, this season of love, this season of joy, this season of peace, this time of wait, I pray that your presence would continue to dwell with us in a whole new way. Father, may you enliven our hearts, enliven our minds, continue to pour out your spirits in this place. And we just ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Another one of my favorite times of year is Christmas, because that means there's a children's program. I love to see our children, who are so full of joy and energy and unpredictability, for lack of a better word, at times, sing and give shout to and praise to Christ and to Jesus this holiday season. Next Sunday is our children's musical. We invite you to invite your friends and family. Next Sunday, it'll be during the 10:30 time of worship that our children will be performing. Be in prayer for not just them, but also those who will be leading them during this time. Also, there will be a time of Christmas caroling, December 9th, for those who are interested in going. People are meeting at the Schutz and Haddle buildings, which are in Goshen, at 6:45 on December 9th. So if you are excited about doing that and want to do that, we invite you to join with those who are gathering. And then also, this week and next week are your last 2 weeks to pick up the angel tree cards in the back by the giant Christmas tree. Those are for the angel tree project, the angel tree program, helping to give presents to those kids who, through no fault of their own, one of their parents are in prison or jail, and just a way to love them and show them Christ's love this holiday season. So we just pray that you would be in prayer for them, the many in our community who are going through this. At this time, we invite all of the children to come forward for this morning's children's story.
Come on up and gather around. I've got some props with me today, all right? Now, did anybody catch the word? Maybe I should ask Hope to tell us. What is the focus of this morning's Sunday? The Advent candle is the candle of love, all right? And love, one of the things that's so awesome about God is that God is love. God loves us. And lots of good things about love. Now, I just want to show you a little bit. I'm going to just suggest that maybe this is one of you guys. Let's say it's all the kindergartners, okay? So this water, this marble that's in the water, can you see it there? Oh, I shouldn't have put that one in. You can hardly see it. Here, we'll put a dark one that you can see a little better. How about that one? You can see that one? So is that marble surrounded with water? Yeah, you know. So I want you to think about the water as being God's love and the marbles as being who we are. Now, what happens if I put a few more in here? Are all these people going to get surrounded by God's love if I put the first graders in, the second graders in, the preschool kids? Huh? What about some of the old folks, the grown-ups? Anybody else? What about if I put the youth in here? Do you think there'll be enough love for them? Spilled a little water. Huh? You think it's enough love for them? What about the junior high? What about those? Think it's enough love for them? Yeah? Okay. Now, what about if we're all in here? Okay. I won't fill it all up because then I got to empty them out later. But what? So we fill it up with lots of marbles in here. Right now, they're kind of sitting there kind of nice. But what would happen if I kind of shook them up a bit? People sometimes rub us the wrong way, don't they? Kind of get in our face. Uh-huh. Is it dripping? Yeah, I figured so. All right. Do you think God's love is big enough for people who even do what God wants them to do? Is it big enough for that? Now, what do you think about God's love? What about if people aren't kind to each other? Does God still love those people? Uh-huh. And what do you think God would say to people who aren't getting along? Would he say, it's okay that you guys are rubbing and rubbing and irritating each other? Would he say that that's a loving way to be? You know, one of the things that Jesus says is we're supposed to love as what? Who's our model of how we're supposed to love? Jesus is our model. We're supposed to love each other as Jesus loved us. Each one of us is completely surrounded by the love of God or by the love of Jesus. Just like this water completely surrounds these marbles. Now, God loves absolutely everybody, those who follow God and those who don't. But for those who follow him, he asks us to show everybody the kind of love that he shows us. So God loves us all, But he asks us to also love those around us. Remember, we're all surrounded by God's love. Sometimes we kind of irritate each other, but we still love each other, all right? Because that's what we want to follow. We follow God's love. All right, let's pray. God, I thank you that you always love us. Sometimes when we mess up, when we get angry at brothers and sisters, at parents, at kids in school, we thank you that no matter what we do, you always love us. But you also call us to love like you love us. And that's how you call us to love others. So thank you, God, for that. Remind us through this Christmas season, kids, grown-ups, youth, that each one of us is to be like you and love each other. In your name I pray. Amen. All right, kids. Ask the ushers to come forward, please. Let's pray. Great God of love, you gave your very best when you brought Jesus into this world. You gave your very best when you showed your love to each one of us. And we give our best to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
This next song we're about to sing, Good Good Father, really has a special meaning to me. As I sang it a few Sundays ago.
Yes.
One of my friends talked to me a few weeks ago and said something that really struck me in an incredible way. Just like put yourself in the spot of a little child right now. Think of yourself, I don't know, 3 years old, 2 years old. You're by the side of a pool and your father is inside of the pool. And you're about to take a jump into the pool. And you're a little scared. You don't know how to swim. But your dad says, come on, trust me. I love you. I'm not going to let you fall. Come on, jump. And he described it as God is in the pool and you're the child. You're about to take the leap. Sometimes he asks us to take these leaps that are so scary. But we just got to remember him saying, trust me. I love you. Come on, jump. Take the jump. And he's just such a good father. He loves us so much. And it brings so much joy to my heart. It's just incredible.
Of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never
you.
just pray that you take our hearts right now. God, we want to just give our whole being to you, because you have paid it all. You've given it all for us. God, I just pray that we could just press in right now to who you are and what you have for us this day. And I hear the Savior say,
love. This week, as I thought about love, I wondered, in my more than 20 years here, how often have I preached about love? And how do you say anything new? So, just so we got one thing clear, I may not say anything new. This is going to be a sermon of repetition. So if during the sermon you think, I heard him say that before, I heard him say that several times this morning, that's okay, just relax. And just soak it in. Love each other. The text is from 1 John chapter 4. If you want to turn your Bibles, 1 John chapter 4. But before we go there, this is just to get it straight. This is what the message is about today. This is the message that you have heard from the beginning. We should love one another. This is the beginning that this is the message we've heard from the beginning, and this is the message that you're going to hear from the beginning of sermon to the end of the sermon. We should love each other. From 1 John chapter 4, beginning with verse 7. Dear friends, let us continue to love one another, for love comes from God. And anyone who loves is born of God and knows God. But anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God loved us that much, surely, surely we should love each other. No one has ever seen God. But if we love each other, God lives in us. And his love is brought to full expression in us. And God has given us his Spirit as proof that we live in him and he in us. Furthermore, we have seen with our own eyes, and now we testify that the Father sent his Son to be the Savior of the whole world. All who confess that Jesus is the Son of God have God living in them, and they live in God. We know how much God loves us, and we have put our trust in his love. God is love. And all who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. And as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. So we will not be afraid on the day of judgment, but we can face him with confidence because we live like Jesus in this world. And I want to repeat that. It's an amazing statement. We will face him with confidence because we live like Jesus in this world. Such has no fear because perfect love expels all fear. If we are afraid, it is for fear of punishment, and this shows that we have not fully experienced God's perfect love. We love each other because he first loved us. If someone says, "I love God," and then hates his Christian brother or sister, that person is a liar. Because how can we, for if we don't love people who we can see, how can we possibly love God who we cannot see? And he has given us this command. Those who love God must also love their Christian brothers and sisters. The word love is used in that passage 27 times. Do you think he's trying to make a point? Do you think he's trying to get something across to us? He just kind of repeats and repeats himself. God loves us. We are called to love God. Because we love God, we love each other. This was written by John, who was a very close friend of Jesus. He often refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. This was one of the last books of the Bible that was written. It was written about AD 90, about 60 years after Jesus had died. And the world was a dire place. Rome had destroyed Jerusalem, and all the Jews were dispersed across the world. The emperor of Rome, Nero, was ruthlessly persecuting and killing Christians. Peter had been martyred. Paul had been martyred. Many Christians were dying for their faith. False doctrine was coming into the church. And this is just this pastoral letter out of this old man, John. And just what he longs for God's people to experience. It is said that John was so old at this point that his disciples, those who followed him, would actually carry him to church. They'd carry him up on the platform because he couldn't walk. And he couldn't give a long sermon. So every Sunday he would say, "Let us love one another." Finally, some people in the church began to ask him, why do you say the same thing every week? He said, that's because that is what Jesus commanded us to do. And if we do this, if we love each other, that's enough. That's sufficient. Love is the theme, we know, for Jesus throughout his teaching and his ministry. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus takes it head on and he says, you know, you've heard it said, and I don't know who was saying this, but you've heard it said you're to love your neighbors and hate your enemies. But Jesus said, I say that you should love your enemies. You should do good to them that hate you, because you know what? Anyone can love a friend who's going to return that love. But it takes God's Spirit, God's love living within us to empower us to love our enemies. Both Jesus and Paul said on numerous occasions that we are called to love our neighbors as ourselves. And that seems like a really high bar. Can I really love my neighbor as much as I love myself? This question was thrown at Jesus one time from a lawyer, and it was a trick question. It was given to him to test him. And the lawyer said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, well, what does it say in the law? The guy knew his Bible. He knew the law. He said, well, it says you're to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbors yourself. And Jesus said, that's right. If you do that, if you love God and love your neighbor, you're going to live. And so the lawyer had a follow-up question. Who's my neighbor? That's kind of where the rubber hits the road, isn't it? Who is my neighbor? And we know the story, the Good Samaritan. Jesus tells the story of this guy going down the road. The thieves come upon him, they beat him, they strip him naked, they take everything he has, and they leave him lying beside the road as dead. Along come two big dudes in the church, the priest and the Levite. These are people who know the law. These are people who teach the law. These are holy, righteous, pious people. They walk by on the other side and they leave the man there for dead. And along comes the hated Good Samaritan. We call him Good. I don't think we understand how much Jesus' listeners would have hated the Samaritans. One time Jesus was traveling through Samaria, his face was towards Jerusalem, it was towards the end of his ministry, and they approached a Samaritan village and they didn't welcome him in. And James and John, the one who wrote this letter, said, Jesus, why don't you just call down fire and burn them all up? Let's just finish this thing right now, Jesus. I guess he hadn't learned yet about love. And it says that Jesus rebuked him. And then Jesus says, you know, this Samaritan who you all don't like. He bandaged up that man's wounds. He put him on his donkey. He took him to the inn. He paid money. And he told the innkeeper, do whatever it takes to make this man well. And if it costs more than I've given you when I return, I will pay you that. And Jesus looks at the lawyer and he says, so who is this man's neighbor? And the lawyer says, well, it's the one who had mercy. Duh. Jesus said, then go and do likewise. Go and show that kind of mercy and that kind of love. Just a bit of a sidestep this morning. One of the things that we see a lot in our news today are Syrian refugees. I haven't seen it so much the last couple of weeks, but we know that there are millions of refugees. At the end of 2014, less than a year ago, there was 6.5 million people displaced inside Syria. There was another 3 million living in Turkey, in Lebanon, and in Jordan. Almost 10 million people displaced from their homes. And I know we say 10 million, it just runs past us. I think if we'd look at one of those people in our eyes, we'd understand what a humanitarian crisis and tragedy this is. And now many of them are wanting to come to Europe and North America. And I know it causes all kinds of feelings within us. and I'm not in any way wanting to be political, but I think we look at the situations in our world, and we must ask the question, through the eyes of Jesus, what would Jesus do? What does Jesus ask us to do in these situations? What does it mean to love my neighbor as myself? What does it mean to love the least of these? Jesus said, whenever you do it to one of the least of these, you're doing it to me. I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and in prison and you visited me, and I was a stranger and you took me in. For followers of Jesus, the response is not a response of fear. It is not a response of hate. It is not a response of apathy. It's not a response of judgment. I am better than them. Our only response as followers of Jesus will be a response of love to whoever that might be. Linda said to the children, God loves everyone. And the challenge to us as his followers is, do we love everyone as well? The way of Jesus is not the easiest way. When we follow Jesus, we may walk different than the world around us. We sure should. But the way of Jesus is the way to live. It's the way of life. Love your neighbor as yourself. And then Jesus took it to a whole new level. That last night when he was with his disciples and Jesus knew that he was about to die, and he said to them, so now I am giving you a new commandment. Love each other. Love each other. Just as I have loved you, so you ought to love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. The way that we live with each other, the way we interact with each other, the way that we love each other is a testimony of God's love. And when the world looks at us, they should be able to see that we are his disciples. When people look at Clinton Frame, when people look at how we respond to each other, how we love each other, what do they see? Are we proof to the world that we are followers of Jesus? Can they see that in us? Are we light in the darkness? As we go through this Advent season, it's a theme of light and darkness. This is how we are called to be light, by loving each other. Talk about repetition. Jesus repeats himself to his disciples that same night. Just a little bit later in chapter 15, he says, this is my commandment. Love each other in the same way that I have loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. This is real love. Jesus, John, in this passage, he says, this is where it gets really real. Not that you love God, but that God loved you so much that he sent his son to die as a sacrifice for your sins. While we were still yet sinners, Christ died for us. And we are called to live that same level of love. Is it easy? It's impossible unless we have the Spirit of Christ deep within us. So let us continue to love one another. I want us to memorize this morning. We're going to repeat it together 3 times, and then we're going to all close our eyes and say it again. If we say it often enough, it just gets to be a part of us. So let's say it 3 times. Let us continue to love one another. Let us continue to love one another. Let us continue to love one another. And now with eyes shut, let us continue to love one another. Thank you. You want to lead us again, Hope? Let us continue to love one another. It should just roll off of our minds. It should just roll out of our hearts and out of our beings. This is the command that Jesus gave us. Let us love one another. And if we do this, it is enough. If we truly can live that out, it is sufficient. Anyone who does not love does not know God. That's a really striking sentence. Anyone who does not love does not know God. You know, we talk a lot about spiritual disciplines. And by doing spiritual disciplines is how we grow in our knowledge of God and how we grow in our faith in God and becoming like God. And we talk about things like Bible study and prayer and meditation and worship. And all of those things are good. Those are all good things that we should all be doing. But none of them will make any difference in us coming into our understanding of God if we don't have love. 1 Corinthians 13, that love chapter. Paul just says it so well. He says, you can speak in the tongues of men and of angels. For us, you can come to worship every Sunday morning and you can sing. You can proclaim God from the rooftops. But if it doesn't come from a heart of love, it is just obnoxious sounds. I don't think God cares if I sing off pitch. But I think God cares if my songs don't come from a heart of love. The prophet Amos told God's people, God is so sick and tired of your religious festivals and your solemn assemblies and all those songs, because what he wants to see from his people is this mighty stream of justice and mercy and love. That's what God desires from us. I can read my Bible every day. I can meditate. I can pray. But if I don't love, it's not going to bring me any closer to God. I can live a life of service. I can deprive myself of pleasure. I can do all of these things. But if it doesn't flow from a heart of love, it doesn't bring me any closer to God or knowing God. Because anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is not living within them. We talk about discipleship in the same way. Normally when we talk about discipleship, we talk about a discipleship path, and we're talking about growing in our knowledge of God. Maybe we should talk about discipleship as action. Maybe as we grow and grow and grow in our faith, what our discipleship really needs to do is it needs to equip us and it needs to compel us to love as Jesus loved. Is that our goal? Is that our goal as we disciple each other, as we grow in our faith? Our ultimate goal is for us to be able to love as Jesus loved. And if we do that, then we will be all about sharing Jesus Christ with our neighbors, with everyone, because it will just become a part of who we are. Spiritual discipline of love. Discipleship of action. When Anita and Matt and I were talking about this Advent series, and we talked about the themes, and the first one is love. And we're talking about what is the opposite of love, and, well, the opposite of love is hate. We all know that, right? But Matt said, and I think Matt is right, that for us today, the opposite of love is apathy. I just don't care. It's not that I'm doing anything wrong or bad. I just don't care. This was kind of brought home to me then last weekend when we met with this church consultant, and he talked about his neighbor, and he talked about reaching out to his neighbor and inviting his neighbor to church, and things just weren't working out, and things were becoming more distant, and he wanted to just give up. And then he thought about, what is the loving thing to do? Now, often when we talk about the opposite of love, we'll talk about fear. We don't do this because we're fearful. We don't share Jesus because we're fearful. But in many ways, that's putting it on the other person, right? It's because I'm afraid of their reaction that I can't share Jesus. I'm afraid of what they might do. But when I have to look within myself and say, you know what, maybe it's because I just don't care. That has everything to do with me and my relationship with God. Does God's love pour out through me? Do I care enough about my neighbor that if I know they don't have a relationship with Jesus and I know they're going to spend eternity in hell, do I care enough to share Jesus with them? No excuses, but to just look within myself. We love each other because he first loved us. I threw this line up there because I think it's such an interesting twist. We love each other because God first loved us. Really? You know, it would make more sense if it said, I love God because he first loved me. And since he first loved me, well, then of course, I love him. That's not what it says. It says, we love each other because God first loved us. If we have experienced God's love fully, if we have experienced that real love of Jesus dying on the cross for us, surely we should love each other. I've often said that if I've experienced the forgiveness of Christ in my life, then I should be able to forgive someone else for something that they've done to me. And I think that's in essence what John is saying here. If you have experienced God's love within you, then you're just going to automatically love each other. If God loves us that much, surely we should love each other. If we say we love God but hate a brother or sister, we are a liar. Who wants to be called a liar? A liar is a horrible thing to be called. This is really strong language. If you say you love God but don't love your brother or sister in the church, you are a liar. Not much sugarcoating going on here. And then he continues with this strong language that if we love God, we must. There's no options. We must love each other. If we disagree with each other, what does Jesus say? You're called to love each other in the same way that I have loved you. If someone has offended me, what does Jesus say? You are to love each other in the same way that I have loved you. If someone is in need, what does Jesus say? You are to love each other in the same way that I have loved you. It doesn't matter how young or how old, how rich or how poor. It doesn't matter what's going on in your life. Jesus says, love each other in the same way that I have loved you. And I want to close with this other statement from John. Dear children, let us not merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by our actions. You know, it's one of the amazing things about Jesus, and Jesus was this great teacher, right? Jesus didn't say, go out and do like I told you to do. He said, do as I do. Let us not merely speak that we love each other, but let us show it by our actions. Could you turn the lights down? The light of love. The light of love shines through the darkness. The light of love overcomes the power of hate. We are called to be a light of love to this world. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning more for anything else than for your great love for us. And God, there is no way that we could ever begin to repay the sacrifice that you made in sending your Son. There is no way that we could ever repay the sacrifice that Jesus made in giving up his life for each one of us. But this morning, Father, we accept your love. And we want your love living within us. We want your love living within us so brightly that the world will see. Empower us to continue to love each other as you loved. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I ask you to stand, and we're going to close this morning by singing the song, Build Your Kingdom Here. May God build his kingdom here at Clinton Frame through us. And God's kingdom will be built, and God's kingdom will thrive if we love each other as Jesus loved.
Our hearts are blazed with hope, like wildfire.
Let's say it again together one more time. Let us continue to love one another. One more time. Let us continue to love one another. May you take the light of God's love to someone that needs it this week. Go in peace.